everyone. It's nice to see many of you here again. We haven't met all of us for a while, like I said, since the day one presentations a few weeks ago. But it's a special pleasure for me to welcome a very special visitor here, a special guest and a special friend of the program, David Ing, who comes all the way from Canada. He's been working for many years and had a great career at IBM, and he's been doing a lot of thinking on systems thinking over, I believe, 15 years and been working with some of the world's leading systems thinkers. So David will take you onto a journey to explore systems thinking over the next 3 hours, talking, trying slides, and do ask if you have questions. Actually, what I would also like to mention is that David is, I think if you have remembered carefully what we've said at the start of the year, you will remember his name, because David is one of the founders of the program. So at the time when the program was founded, if you recall from the slide, it said that IBM was involved, that David was the person who was involved at the time to bring forth the idea and the need for the program and design the program. And I believe you're the first one who has written the first curriculum. So yes. The idea of going by topics and having the readings comes from David. So I consider we start with a warm applause for this session. Yesterday's class as kind of change manager person, this is a thoughtful architect, so this is a consultant type who thinks very carefully. And also, before I give you the word, I'd also like to just shortly introduce two special guests we have here. We have two as gentlemen, and we'd like to have a few other students possibly from Malta University who are joining what Danish students from Malta, one is from a discipline class, and we have Yao Ling, who is a scientist, PhD, plus years at the chemistry department at Aalto. And she's here as from a teaching observation perspective. She's doing her pedagogical studies and she wants to go to different universities to explore how teaching occurs across Helsinki universities. So she is here to participate and just listen to us throughout the day just to get a sense as to what's going on. But let's have a fantastic day and thank you, David, for being with us. And we look forward to an exciting morning.
Thank you. So it's always great to be back. The first university I actually came to in 2003 was actually here. I came with my friend David Hawk, and he was teaching, and we had a class over at Aalto University in Tuta. But he was over here working and teaching, in effect, some of the English classes. We do it for a favor. So I came over, and I asked David, oh, you know, what is the audience? And they said, oh, these are IT students. And I said, oh, well, you know, I spent all this career at IBM. I could probably give this talk. And so that's when I discovered that without preparation, I can give a talk for 75 minutes straight up. So, and try not to do that to you. I'll try to speak a little bit slower because I know that some of you may have problems. Sakin speaks really fast. So, if I'm going too fast, slow me down. Now, what I'm going to do is, the name of this presentation, which I've created especially for this class, is Service System Thinking with Generative Pattern Language. This is actually the result of 3 years of research, and I presented this content at a conference on October 30th in San Francisco. So you are getting the most leading edge research there, and I hope that you'll take some of this. Now, it's not going to be a theoretical. What I've done is I've changed the way I'm presenting this because the reason for taking 3 years was I needed to go into some communities and show that I actually understood what they were doing, but I really wanted to change what they're doing. So I had to go through all that. So there's a lot of theory work, which I will cover at the end if we have time. But the goal of this presentation is to give you actually something practical. You may use this in your thesis. I have written 27 patterns in my dissertation, which I finished last Thursday and handed in. Not completed, the first manuscript, but since August, I have been doing nothing but writing patterns. And they're not that easy to do. So let's get into this a little bit. This is the paper. I'll show you in a moment where it is. So this is the paper that I presented on October 30th, 29th, whatever. The reason it's called Pattern Manual is it leads back to 1967 at the University at Berkeley, University of California, Berkeley. there was an architect, Christopher Alexander. How many of you have heard of a pattern language, Christopher Alexander? Okay. It's something that you should look at. It's in every library in the world. Okay. It was idea that if we are going to build buildings, what is it that makes up good buildings? And so in 1967, and I had to go to the Berkeley Library to get this, is the original pattern manual, which is the founding of the Center for Environmental Structure at Berkeley. He published this thing called pattern manual for, and it was multi-service centers. And then it took him 10 years with a team to publish the book that has become famous called A Pattern Language. And so when I went to this conference in San Francisco, this was all the people who studied under Christopher Alexander. And I'm not an architect. This is called the Pearl Conference, the Portland Urban Architecture Research Laboratory. So in Portland, Oregon, all the students are there and they're carrying on this work. Last year, I went to the Purple Sock Conference, which is focused on patterns for social change. I went to that in Vienna. Not Vienna, it's in Austria, flying to Vienna to Donau University. And the year before that, I went to the so-called PLOP Conference, Pattern Languages of Programs, where it's done in software development. People here in software, have they ever heard of design patterns? Okay, this is one of the reasons I need to bring this stuff back, is that there's a large body of work that has come over a long period of time, and people have forgotten about it, and it's really good work. It needs some tweaking, but when I was at IBM, and people ask, well, you know, why are you doing pattern language? I was in IBM, and I was 28 years at IBM from 1985 to 2012, and in around the mid-90s, say 94, 95, 96, IBM went into the services business. And the challenge they had was that they had all these different people with all these different methods. And so the clients were complaining because IBM, as a consultant, you're coming, and so we get the management consulting people come in and they do some strategy work and figure out what this business unit's going to do. And then we get the IT people coming in and say, well, we need to understand your business direction. And they say, IBM, we just paid you $500,000 to do strategy, and you're coming and asking again to do strategy work? Like, we're not going to pay you for that. So this led to the IBM Global Services Method. And the IBM Global Services Method was based off pattern language. And everyone's forgotten about it because one of the things that destroyed the IBM Global Services Method was the acquisition of PricewaterhouseCoopers. Because when IBM Global Services and PricewaterhouseCoopers merged, it was two organizations of the same size, and unfortunately, one of those things happens, they lost that knowledge. But it's actually documented in some journals of the ACM and other places, and so I can actually cite outside, and if a certain number of people I know who were the methodologists at IBM. And so that's why it's pattern language. The service system thinking I will explain, because we're moving towards service economy, and that was the original premise for, in 2006, when this industrial management program was founded. At that point, Kaina Tukyanainen had just become head of the program, and Mina Takala is my friend. We've been doing research since 1999 together. And I come to Finland in 2005. I was visiting. I was kind of depressed with my job, whatever. And so Mina has this habit of finding things for me to do. And so we're having a meeting with Tina, and it says, "Oh, okay, this program is now created. How should we do this program?" He said, Mina said, "Oh, David will help you. He'll write the program." And it's like, "Oh, I will." So that's how it happened. Now, I really appreciate the Finnish style in which you do programs, because you do things first, you make the mistakes, you say the mistakes, you learn, and you move on. Okay. Over in the United States, they tend to plan and plan and plan and plan and plan, and then they execute. So the first time we teach the course, it's not perfect. It's nowhere near perfect, and we learn a lot. So JP is a student in the Creative Sustainability Program, and that was another one that I was teaching. And I started in 2010, and that was for two system thinking courses, and it's like, wow, that was really hard. So over 5 years, we've learned how to teach these things. It takes a while to mature these things. Anyway, so the reason this proposal for discussion is I am coming in to architects. I am coming into software developers. I'm asking them, look, okay, Christopher Alexander is very well known. He was very well known. If you have a master's degree in computer science and you don't know who, you have not read the Design Patterns book, you should be shocked, because it's one of the top 10 books in computer science. And if you were an architect and you don't know who Christopher Alexander is, you should be shocked, because he's such a big figure. He's controversial, but if you don't even know the name, then you should go to the library and just take out the book. And it's actually an interesting book. So that is the that's the paper. It's available on my website, and for those of you who really like being right on time, this has been a harrowing trip for me. If you go to coevolving.com/pubs, it's at the bottom here. You can actually download it right now. I'll eventually get it up on the blog, but the slides are there if you want to follow along. And so coevolving.com is my website, and I keep all the content open so people can get to it. Okay. So, here's the topic for today. This is what we're going to cover. I'm going to have a discussion about architecting versus designing. And that's semi-controversial, but I'll give you some thinking about that. And the way I'd like to do that is encourage you to think about what's the difference between architecting and designing. Because there's been all this hype about design thinking. What do these people do is different, what's the same. You may or may not agree with me, which is fine, because when you're talking about these sorts of terms, architects have vested interest, and designers have vested interest. I'm neither an architect nor a designer. In IBM, I had the title of business architect, which is also not what people think it is, because a business architect in the IT sense usually means the person understands the business system as opposed to the IT system. Then people go, oh, well, business architecture is a sub-discipline of IT architecture. And I'm going, no. I do organizational redesign. When you put an IT system in, does it impact the work? And then you need to change the IT, and then change the organization. And they go, we don't do that. And I go, well, a business architect might. Because a business architect has to understand enough about the IT, and has to understand enough about organization design to do both work. So, I'm then going to go into the Alexandrian example, and I'm going to do this one backwards. I've taken the slides from the other presentation, and I've actually left out Christopher Alexander's original stuff, because if you don't know it, then why should I teach it to you, then unteach you, right? So I'm going to skip that, I'll come back at the end, and I'll talk a little bit about it. We're then going to have an exercise where we're going to try out writing pattern language. So I put up a document here, and what we're going to sit down up here. Now, you're doing thesis projects already, or you're headed towards doing thesis projects, and many of you will be studying service systems. And I'll explain what service system is, but I'm going to ask you to work with me a little bit, and we'll talk through creating a pattern for that service system. And there are many patterns. There are many patterns, so we'll just do a few so we get an idea of how this works. After we've done that, let's get a break here somewhere, I'll go back and I'll do some of the background work on systems thinking. For those of you who watched the video, the lecture I gave last year was very, very extensive on systems thinking. And people kind of go after a while, oh, that's really nice, but why do you use it? So what you'll find is that systems thinking is at the foundation of pattern language. Christopher Alexander was a systems thinker, but unless you're a systems thinker, you don't recognize that. And so it changes the way that you think about the world, changes the way that you think about buildings, architecture, services, all these sorts of things. So I'll do that. And the last part is one on ignorance and errors. And so why are we even bothering to do pattern language? How should we be thinking about this? And I'll get into some of the more recent research. There's work with Ian Mitroff that I've been working with. Okay, here's a question. Is thinking different across agricultural systems, industrial systems, and service systems? Now, supposedly you have this term industrial management. Does that mean you don't manage agricultural systems and you don't manage service systems? It's like, okay. So, one way of looking at this, in around 2003, we had this issue at IBM. Because IBM, as you know, you've heard about, IBM used to be a hardware computer company. It made all its revenue from hardware, and then switched over and became a services company. So around 2003, about half of IBM's revenue is coming from services. Great. They're in head office, headquarters, and they ask IBM Research, half our revenue is now in services. How much research does IBM do in services? Like, less than 1%? Okay, let me understand this. 50% of our business comes from services, and IBM Research is doing next to nothing on researching services. Yeah, that's right. So this one guy, Jim Sporer, created this field, and you can look this up, called service science. Service science. Is there a science of services? Well, we've actually had this problem at IBM before. It happened in the 1960s. And IBM went to universities and made this declaration. The students that you are graduating universities don't have the skills that IBM wants to hire. They said that in the 1960s. And the universities say, sure we do. And the math department says, we see what you're doing, we do that, and IBM said, that's not it. And then the engineering department says, we do that, and IBM said, that's not it. And the philosophy department says, we do that, and IBM said, that's not it. So then the next question is, okay, IBM, what is it you want? And the answer is, we don't know, you're a university, you're smart people, help us figure this out. This field was called, eventually, computer science. So, for all of you, computer science was a term before all of you were born, right? So, there's the trick, right? So now, IBM comes out and says, we have this new field. In 2003, Jim Sporer started this. So we have this field called service science. And everybody goes, there's no science in services. Now, after he said it was going to take 10 years, and sure enough, it took 10 years. There are now journals on service science. There are conferences on service science, and there's active research going on. And it's actually not just service science. It's what he calls extended. First, he called service science, management, engineering, and design. And then it gets like he keeps adding on letters to it at the end, right? But the idea is there's something different going on. So if we look at the history of studying the way that we kind of manage the world, think of management, design, engineering, pick whatever perspective you want. You used to have agricultural systems. How do agricultural systems work? What drives them? The primary thing that drives the agricultural system is the weather, the seasons of the year. Right? So you decide that you are going to have, if you were a farmer, if you're a farmer here, I don't know if you do this, that farmers, they work all summer, and then in the winter, they go fly off on vacation because not much to do, right? Or you just do a little bit of maintenance work. But you work long hours in the summer, and harvest time is hell, and spring planting time is not great either. In winter, there's not much you can do. So the whole agricultural system is driven like a sundial. It's driven by the sun. So imagine you are coming now at the Industrial Revolution. The Industrial Revolution is run by machines, a period of machines. And so JP is my great farmer out here. I say, oh, JP, not doing too well on those crops, are you? Like, it's a lot of work. Yeah, it's a lot of work. And I said, look, I've got a deal for you. I can guarantee you guaranteed pay. You come to my factory. You work 9 to 5. I'll give you 2 weeks vacation, steady pay, you know, all that sort of stuff. And you don't have to be out there in the fields in the summer, and you know, your crops won't fail. You know, I'll pay you. JP says, great, I'll do that. Okay, come and see me. You can start Monday. You start Monday. We work 9 to 5. I'll see you like 9 o'clock. JP says, you mean sunrise? No, we work 9 to 5. Okay, but JP says, if I, we work on the farm like while there's daylight. And I said, yeah, but we work 9 to 5. We have machines, they work on shifts, you know, we have 3 shifts, we have to. And he says, then, but you lose all that productivity. And what happens in the winter, I have to come to work in the dark and I have to go home in the dark. And there's 9 to 5. I said, we work 9 to 5. And that is because in the industrial system, we work on the schedule of machines. We do not work on the schedule of the sun. Okay, service system. How do we work with a service system?
24/7.
24/7, right. That's not a good, maybe we're back better off. You're on vacation in the winter, right? So 24/7 is not such a great proposition. One of the things that happened at IBM while I was there. Okay, go ahead.
The schedules of your customers.
Yes, the schedule of your customers. That's very good. What do you?
I would have said the same.
Yes, yes. One of the things that happened at IBM while I was there, and it was an interesting article, is that IBM stopped counting vacation. Because what they discovered was, here's the first statistic, is that IBMers almost never take their full vacation allotment, which is not good. And two, you've got a measurement plan already. So if you're a salesperson, you have this sales target. If you are in development, you have to get this product out, whatever. We each have those plans. So why do you have vacation planning? Because if you have vacation planning, then one, you need to implement an IT system to track vacations. Two, the employee has to spend the time actually putting stuff into the system. And three, the manager has to now manage it. So IBM said, take whatever vacation you need. Don't take so much you're going to get fired, right? You know, that's the different way of working. So with that philosophy, when I was in consulting, so you know, we track hours, I know exactly that I used to work 56 hours to bill 40, because we bill 40 hours and we have non-billable time, all sorts of stuff. And so the sort of thing that I did, and it's still an interesting practice, in Toronto when I'm home, I don't know if they have it here, the movie theaters have a, used to be Toonie Tuesdays, because it was $2 to go see a movie. And only on Tuesday, because it's the slowest day of the week. And so my wife and I would go see a movie on Tuesday afternoon, in the middle of a workday, quote unquote, the middle of a workday. Now, I'm already working 40 hours, 50 hours a week, you know, who cares if I put it on my calendar and say, you know, I'm going to see a movie. Okay, that's not exactly an agricultural system. That's not exactly an industrial system. So there's something going on that's a little bit here, and it all is driven around information technology, because we're all carrying these things. The question is, in essence, you have to ask is, if the phone rings, do I answer it or do I not answer it? If the email comes, do I respond or do I not respond? And it's now become your choice. And you look at it, and yes, it's like, oh, it's a customer, I'll answer, right? Yeah, so it becomes a different way of thinking. So there's something going on here that is different from industrial systems. What is that? Let's try to understand that a little better. Okay, these are service systems. Service systems are society, and this is the way that Jim Spore did this. He ranked this from concrete abstract, and he did this while working with the US government. Because the question is, if we are in a service economy, how should we be changing our education system? And so he said, okay, first we want to start off with systems that move, store, harvest, and process. So in kindergarten, transportation systems, when the child is young, you have to get them to the school. May have to take them on a bus. You could take them on the metro, all these different modes. But they learn that, oh, okay, you get on the metro and then it transfers to a bus. That is a system. There is water waste management. So in grade one, you could teach them this, your water. Your water comes out of the tap. Well, actually, it doesn't come out of the tap. You could take grade one kids and you could take them to the water refinery where it's all purified, taking the sewage plant, these sorts of things, and they come and understand what happens when the water goes down the toilet and comes out of the other end in the tap, right? Food and global supply chain. It's amazing how many people think that meat already comes wrapped in plastic. Children think that food, you open the refrigerator and there's always food. Well, there's actually a system behind that. Energy and energy grid. How do we get electricity? Information, communication, technology, infrastructure. Maybe like grade four, they now have a mobile phone. In Finland, this means that younger, they get younger than that. But by then, they should actually figure out how is it you actually talk into the end of one system and the end of your phone, and someone on the other end magically around the world can talk back. Try to understand that on the first set of systems. The second set of systems, which are more complicated, are systems that enable healthy, wealthy, and wise people. Building and construction. People don't think about building and construction as one of the world's largest service industries, but it is. It builds buildings, something that wasn't there, right? Banking and finance, people now recognize that as a big service industry. Retail and hospitality, healthcare. Healthcare is a really big system. And then education, including universities. And so now in grade nine, it's pretty funny, they've been in school for like 9 years and now they get to learn why they're there. How's that work? Why would you want to go to university? The last set are systems that govern. The government of cities, government of regions, of states, and nations. They go from the most concrete to the more abstract. So these are all service systems. And they serve people. So I'll give you a definition. This is from, I have not pulled it. This is from the Institute for Manufacturing from Cambridge University. And IBM worked with this on this. And so the official definition is kind of, you read like this. A service system is a dynamic configuration of resources, and those resources are people, technology, organization, shared information. The service system creates and delivers value, and the value through is done through service, and the value is between a provider and a customer. A service system can be a complex system. The complex system has interactions that interface between the provider and the customer and the customer, and suppliers and suppliers. Okay. Now, the reason that I use this one definition, because there are many definitions of services, is this is the one that is a systems view. And so there's a trick in teaching services and service systems, and I come from a system thinking community, a system sciences community, and there's a lot of people that do work in services that are not focused on the system. So a lot of the research that comes, I don't know if any of you have read about service dominant logic, comes out of marketing, okay? Service dominant logic, why do you have service dominant logic coming out of marketing? Because before it was all product oriented, goods oriented. But essentially, when you go and do service dominant logic, it's a marketing thing. It doesn't necessarily go back into the whole system. So if you are a manufacturer of whatever parts, you know, cars or steel, if you're a manufacturer of steel, you really want to talk about service dominant logic. No, that's something that goes to the marketing people. Well, now let's talk about either the service system. And you can ask the question, does a steel plant serve its customer? That's a different question. Because we say that it creates and delivers value. What is the value? And where is that value? And where are the interactions?
Yes.
Is this definition that you have shown us, is this something you would say is a pattern language to display in this way?
No.
Okay.
No. This is just a definition they have. Pattern language would be much more complicated. I'll get back to you. Okay, so why do we care about service systems? This is a very old study in 2007. And the way you read this, this is a little tricky to read. We have material, and we have information, and we have products, and we have services. Okay? So the what's happened is that in 2007, 56% of GNP, this would be the United States, the Americans doing this research, was in service economy. And if you look at this, what they were seeing is that this line is moving this way. So it's moving from services to products, and it's moving this way, which is from materials towards information. Sorry, moving this way. Okay. Yeah. So this is getting bigger, this is Google. This is getting smaller, this is GM. Okay? So when we started this program in 2006, this is one of the things that informed that program. When we're designing an industrial management program and it's brand new, do you want to design for this or do you want to design for this? And so the design was for this. Okay, I'm going to switch a little bit. I talked about Christopher Alexander being at Berkeley. How many of you have heard the term wicked problems? Okay. In the 1970s, there was a person named Horst Riddle, and he had this idea about why it was that when we take an engineering approach to solving problems, things don't work. And so he created this term called a wicked problem. And with that, he created an IBIS, an issue-based information system. Okay, so what is a wicked problem? Number one, there's no definitive formulation of the wicked problem. Okay, so climate change is a wicked problem. How are you going to define climate change? Okay, it depends where you live, right? I live in Canada, you live in the Northern Hemisphere. For me, I don't know that global warming is such a bad thing. Okay, is that evident? So people in the South have a problem with it. It's like, okay, well, then how do they define it? How do we define it? Number two, wicked problems have no stopping rule. A lot of focus on problems. So there's an issue with the word problem. What is a problem? When you come to it from a systems thinker, Russ Acuff has this term problematique, which is a system of problems. So if you have a problem, like you have your car, you're driving your car and the tire blows out, okay? You have a problem. Your tire is blowing out. You replace the tire, the solution, it's fixed. Okay. Looking at something like climate change, you can't fix climate change. You can't fix the global economy. You can't fix migration. You can't fix these things. You can make them better, and you can make them worse, but there's no stopping rule that says, okay, global warming tackled, we're done. We never have to look at it again. It's going to come back. Right? That's just the way the world is. Third, solutions to wicked problems are not true or false, but they're good or bad. And what is good and what is bad depends on who you are. Number four, there is no immediate and no ultimate test of a solution to a wicked problem. So how do you know when it's actually done? You don't. Five, every solution to wicked problems is a one-shot operation because there's no opportunity to learn by trial and error. Every attempt counts significantly. You make this change, and it impacts everyone. There's been subsequent research. Jerry Rabbits had this idea called post-normal science. The example he uses is nuclear power plants. Okay? So if you want to put a nuclear power plant, you could just say, well, let the engineers do it. And the scientists and the engineers, and you know, we won't even pay attention to them. But that's really not what happens. Because when you're doing nuclear power, yes, it has benefits, but there are risks. And the question is, have we understood all the risks? Wouldn't it be nice to have a discussion where you say, I see the budget for a nuclear power plant, you guys need to spend more. That would be a great discussion. You guys need to spend more because we want it safer. That'd be great. I can't imagine a politician ever coming and saying, yes, we want to spend more on nuclear power plant. But if you want it safe, maybe we should do that. But then, as soon as we start getting those sorts of questions, we take it out of the hands of the experts. We now take it into the people. And the people have the knowledge. Because if we're going to have this question, are we going to have a nuclear power plant or not have a nuclear power plant? You're pretty sure that most of the scientists and engineers are in the industry and they go, this is safe, we're going to do this, it's going to cost this amount. There will be some scientists on the other side, but you're going to have the discussion. And it's called post-normal science because we're into paradigm shift sorts of things, and we actually can't know what's going to happen. Every solution to the wicked problem is a one-shot operation. We're going to create a nuclear plant, and once you put it there, it's not like you're going to turn it off the next day. And it's not like you could create 5 nuclear plants and try them all and then say, oh no, we're going to shut down 4 of them. That's just not the way it works. So we get the wicked problem. Wicked problems do not have an innumerable or exhaustively describable set of potential solutions, nor is there a well-described set of permissible operations that can be incorporated into the plan. And so this would be great if you could say, we have to do either A or B. And someone says, no, you can do A and B, or you can do neither. Every wicked problem is essentially unique. Every wicked problem is considered to be a symptom of another problem. Wicked problems connect to each other. The discussion on nuclear power ties to climate change. There's actually an argument that if we have more nuclear power, it will reduce fossil fuels, which will reduce carbon emissions, right? So it's like, okay, 2 wicked problems. The existence of a discrepancy between wicked problems can be explained numerous ways. The social planner has no right to be wrong. Planners are liable for the consequences they actually generate. Now, this is the part where we start getting the post-normal science, which is, how much do we trust the planners? Are they people that just plan, or are they people that just do? One of the interesting tidbits about IBM, the people, I know IBM is a mystery to a lot of people, is that you think in a corporation that size, IBM must have a huge corporate planning staff. And actually, it doesn't. IBM doesn't have a huge corporate planning staff. They have business unit managers, business unit executives. And the answer comes down, okay, so you are responsible for this software product. The whole thing is all yours. The guy goes, great. Can I get some help on this? Yeah, you can get whatever help you want. It's out of your budget. You decide if you want to spend on consultants, if you want to spend, so it's all yours. But the decision is in that person, in that leader. And these leaders tend to not be autocratic. They tend to actually now go, oh, God, that's a big decision. I'm not going to make it by myself. So I have all my people, we'll work on it. So there's a difference between a consultant and a business unit executive. So you've heard the joke about ham and eggs. Heard the joke about ham and eggs? So the joke about ham and eggs is that the chicken contributes to the outcome, but the pig is committed. Right? So when you have this idea of planning, I don't know if any of you are actually thinking of this career in planning. The planners I respect the most are the people that do it as part of their job because they have to. They have to make a decision, they have to make a plan, they have to lead. I was a consultant for IBM for 12 years. And I'll tell you the reason I left as a consultant. People that pay for consultants are actually the laggards of the industry. Because the other job I had at IBM, the best job I had at IBM was what's called market development. In IBM, we start off with a product, and I'll go way back. So in 1988, I worked on this product called data interpretation system. Metaphor data interpretation system. There's a workstation in the Museum of Modern Art. And today it sounds a little bit ridiculous, but a way I describe it, it's a Mac on the internet with a graphically user interface that writes SQL to database. So it's what we have today, but we had this before the Mac. We had this before Windows, right? And the reason that IBM got interested in Metaphor was that the CEO of Procter & Gamble called the president of IBM and said, we've got a little issue here. We've got our whole business, our whole marketing department. This is in the beginning of supermarket scanner data. Our whole company is relying on this little tiny company, and if it goes under, we're in big trouble. So IBM, can you help us out and take a look at the company? And in 1988, IBM invested $10 million in this company. It was a Xerox PARC spinoff. These people got the rights, and they, in effect, created, back in 1988, what we all take for granted today is, you know, you connect to the internet, get data, all sorts of stuff that happened back then. But because they had used this in consumer packaged goods, brand management, category management, selling toothpaste, diapers, you know, all these sorts of things, they didn't know if anyone else would use it. They would go and say, okay, would you use this in a bank? Would you use this in a retail industry? Now, I happened to be working in a retail industry for IBM at that time. So what I did was I went to one of the customers. I was working, I got an assignment to work for 2 months in Los Angeles. I live in Toronto, went to Los Angeles. Took my family, took my son, one son at that point. And we lived in a hotel, and I was building and working with fashion accessory buyers. So these are women that you know, sell earrings in a department store, you know, scarves, these sort of things. One of the interesting things, after I built the demo, we had the demo come in, and so the door opens and the fashion buyers come in. I'm looking and it's like, they're all dressed like fashion models. These women don't care about spreadsheets, they don't care about data, they care about fashion, right? That's market development work. Working on leading edge technologies with customers, and they're not nickel or diming, it's a partnership where, you know, IBM is exploring stuff and it may become a product. And that's a lot of fun. When I worked in consulting, is the reason that people hire consultants is because they need organization change and something they can't do by themselves. And if it's a big change, hopefully you bring in a consultant once. It's for a very short period of time. They help you reorganize, and then you leave. But now, remember ham and eggs. The person that stays at the company is the one that's committed. So I have a lot of respect for internal consultants. Internal consultants that do change are not the same as external consultants. They all work in different ways, but that's my bias. Okay, so if we have this idea of wicked problems, how do we approach wicked problems? And Riddle created what was he called an information, issues-based information system. And so you start off with a question. You don't start off with an assertion or a statement. You start off with a question. And that question leads to ideas, which you have pro or con. So the question is, should we build a nuclear plant? Well, that leads to another question. How does nuclear plant relate to the global warming? How does it relate to other things? Okay, so question. Should we build a nuclear plant? You get this idea, and the idea could be, we're going to need a lot of money for that. Where do we get the money? And so the pros are it's going to be very expensive. The cons are, the pros are the long-term costs are really good. The con is the upfront cost is really high. And so their software, the compendium software is an example, it's available on the internet, and you could do issue-based information. And so when you're drawing, when people always draw circles and bubbles and stuff like that, and I always wonder what they mean. Here's one way of doing it, and there's a whole logic behind doing this. And this is because in the system of problems, when you fix one thing in the system, something else is going to break somewhere else. So you're going to, there's never a silver bullet, as we say, right? You're going to kill that wolf, that werewolf, with one silver bullet. There is no such thing. So we have to change from this idea of a simple problem into a wicked problem. Now, not all problems are wicked. As I said, you blow out a tire on your car. It's not a problem. You go replace the tire. It's not a wicked problem unless you know the power goes out and you can't get a tire and. But there's also a difference between complicated and complex. A complicated system you can take apart. So most, for those of you who ever built a computer from scratch, which I know is getting to be rare now that everyone does these phones, I'm an old guy, so I don't like building computers, but I do that once in a while. You can take a computer apart, you can swap the motherboard, you can swap in the hard drive, you know, all sorts of things. It's designed as a complicated machine. It is not a complex machine in the sense of the brain. You can't separate the brain from the rest of your body and swap it out. So those of you who think that, you know, you take your brain out and you're going to preserve it in liquid nitrogen, and when they solve that aging problem, they're going to put the brain back in the body. No. The human system is a complex system. But computers are complicated. A wicked problem is for complex systems. If you can solve a complicated problem or make the problem complicated, or change a wicked problem into being complicated, then that's a good thing. Then you fix it. But it may be one. Number two, wicked problems have no stopping rule. No stopping rule, right? When is it you're done? You're going to build a computer? Okay, we'll build a computer. When it actually boots up and it actually works, you're done, right? You're not building anymore, you're just using it. When it breaks down, you fix it, build up, there's a stopping rule. There are some people who like to tweak their computers a lot, but that's the upside. Okay, so we're going to come back. You're going to see this sort of thinking coming in. Okay, more talking about problems. In 1969, and this is in the architecture literature, there's a differentiation between what's called problem seeking and problem solving. And problem seeking was architectural programming. The idea behind problem seeking is looking for problems worth solving. I don't know if any of you have architects in your families or, you know, have friends who are architects. One thing about architects who are really the ones that want challenges, they want to pick a project that's hard because it's interesting. So they don't want to build another house on the prairie, you know, like this. What they want to do is they want to build a house on the side of a mountain that's not going to fall off. They want to build it over a lake that no one else can do. They want to build, like, they want to do something hard. And what they are doing is they are doing problem seeking. What problems are worth solving? Right? So if it's on the side of a hill, then you need a special form of steel, you know, there'll be some more structural, and that's the problem. We go, oh, well, we have new technologies, we can make that easy. Right? But we all have problems and issues in our lives. So actually, I prefer that if you change this problem seeking to issue seeking, for the reasons I told you before, that problem is a bit different. Because if we think about this, and we have wicked problems in the world, which parts or which problems are worth solving? We all have problems in our life. Getting here this morning is a problem. You know, I started late last night with JP, and, you know, so now I have my homework on computer, so I don't have to get up. But it's like, yeah, that's a problem. It's a problem I can deal with, right? It's a problem I can deal with. It's worth it to get here. It's worth it. Other things, it's like, I'll let them go. It's no problem. We all make choices in our lives. So as opposed to going into problem-solving mode, which is really more an engineering approach, if you can define the problem, we can solve the problem. Solving the problem is usually not the issue, or it shouldn't be the issue. We should be looking towards what are the problems that are worth solving. If you have a service system, lots of things. You go to a hotel, there's lots of problems in a hotel. Which are the ones that are worth serving? Which are the ones that are worth fixing? So customer ones, the ones that show up to customers, they are the ones that are worth fixing. But that doesn't mean you can't always fix stuff in the back end. I don't know if people in software development here, you ever heard of the term technical debt? Technical debt is what happens when you do a lot of building of software, and if you build software and then you start working on it, and you need another, and they want more functions, so you build it bigger, and you build it bigger, and you build it bigger. And then when you get to the end of this thing, it's a kludge. It's a mess because you just keep adding things on, and someone comes along and says, I can take that whole thing and rebuild it and be nice and clean and be like this, run falls well and fast. But going from that incremental and fixing it, that's what's called technical debt. At a certain point, you should actually go back in and say, everyone's saying, the system works great. I'm going, I got to go back in now and fix the system inside. Say, but don't do that, it works fine. They go, well, no, there's technical debt associated with it. We've been taking on technical debt as we go along. So you fix things for the customer. You also have to fix things internally because the technical debt gets too big. Because if anything goes wrong, you have to rearrange and refix all these systems, then you get to that challenge. So I'll give you an example now, which is, I don't know how many of you really thought about how the internet works. And what does internet really mean? Okay, so at IBM, IBM in the 2000s made all of its money essentially on internet technologies inside of companies. And the sort of presentation you get to IBM, I'd say, okay, so you know, I'm at a customer's place and I say, you use the computer a lot? Oh yeah, sure we do, yeah, you know, kind of high-tech family. Okay, so let's see, you go home, you turn on your computer, it's not already on all the time, you turn on your computer, and what do? You go to Google, you type in what you want to see, you do email, stuff like that, it's like, oh great, okay. And they have all the, you go to Twitter, you have Facebook, all sorts of stuff. Great, okay. So what do you do in the office? We go to the office, and I log into my email, and then I have to log into the expense system, and I have to log into the knowledge management system, and the log in, it's like, so you're telling me that at home, everything is easy and it's all done, but inside your company, it's all these different systems. They go, yeah, well, that's what IBM did in the 2000s. IBM took the internet and it put it inside of companies. And the most interesting one I heard of was the telephone directory inside of IBM. IBM's a multinational company. There's a phone book in every country. So there's two ways of approaching this problem. One is you create a standard that everyone uses the same telephone directory throughout the world. Or else, the old system used to work. It's not like back in mainframe days, it's not like we didn't have telephones back then, telephone numbers. Or you could do the other way, which is leave the telephone directories where they are and link them to each other. So when I change a phone number in Canada, here in Finland, it actually goes and changes into the phone directory in Finland. So we still have two telephone directories, and they're kept in sync with each other. That's how the internet works. It is not getting one big complex system. It is now creating complicated systems that are tied together. Now, complicated systems are manageable with computing. It's pretty straightforward. Complex systems, which are wicked, are a different story. Which problem do you want to solve? Do you want to solve a complex problem, or do you want to solve a complicated one? Well, at a certain point, if you start keep centralizing everything, you need a bigger computer, you know, you have one massive, massive, massive computer. The alternative would be, well, we actually could do multiple computers, multiple small computers. This happens in the technology that people hadn't appreciated it, because in computer chips, so people are technical, computers used to be one core. They have, in the CPU, they have one core, right? And then they went to multi-core, two cores, three cores, two cores, four core, eight core. And what are they doing? So they're taking the processing power as opposed to being on one chip and they're distributing over two chips. Why do you do that? The reason is that when you were looking at the way chip technology was created, it's on this curve where you can create faster chips. When you create faster chips, the heat goes up. And when the heat goes up, you get the old problem. There's this problem which you guys never experienced. But it used to be that in the old days of laptops, the laptops would get so hot, you couldn't put it on your lap. Right? That's because the processor is too fast. It's generating too much heat. So they've done something that was complex, and they made it complicated. And you go, wow, having to manage four cores or eight cores, it's like, wow, that's really complicated. You go, yeah, but what's the alternative? A chip that is now you need to carry a refrigerator with you when you take your laptop? It's like, so converting a complex problem into a complicated problem is not necessarily a bad thing and can give you different solutions. Problem seeking, which one do you want to solve? Okay, now the question is, what is architecture and what's design? There's a statement which is pretty interesting from Grady Booth. All architecture is design, but not all design is architecture. my definition, and I'm willing to bend on this, I think of architectural thinking as shaping the structure of the environment. What you're doing is that you've got space, you're putting up walls. You're not filling in the walls. So you have an architect. Architect usually doesn't give you and say, this furniture has to go in this room. He just puts up the walls and puts up the plumbing, that sort of stuff. Design thinking, one of the definitions for Tim Brown is divergence depth, which is creating choices, and convergence depth, making choices. You fill spaces. So there's something different between architecture and design, and when you're doing architecting, you're doing some kind of design.
Mainly for JP, I'll put up this next one because he's a systems thinker.
Living systems are autopoietic. Autopoietic means they're self-organizing and self-generating. Assembly lines are autopoietic, which are external organizing, external generating. Now, this is a real fine point that we get in the systems theory. What's it mean to be a living system? A living system, your body is a living system. Organizations are living systems. The world is a living system. Is self-organizing and self-generating? So self-organizing, we self-organize our own lives. We decide we're going to move this way, move that way. Social systems are self-organizing. So we decide we're going to meet a certain time, and we meet. It's self-generating in that we get our own food, we get our own inputs, and we produce our own outputs, take care of our waste, and sort of stuff. An assembly line, when you build a product, it's externally organized. So in effect, you're architecting a product. You're designing a product, and it goes into the assembly line, and then externally generating, you build it. But then when it comes off the end of the assembly line, it's done, right? Most products are not designed to be taken apart and reused for other things. That is actually a product architecture question. Are you going to build a complex system? So, a car, a bicycle, let's do bicycles. Bicycles. Are you going to design a bicycle as a whole system? Or are you going to design just the bike parts that we put together? Because you can go to a bike shop and you say, I want a custom-made bike. And they go, okay, you know, take a couple of days and we can custom build it. We'll do a frame for you, we'll pick the cranks, we'll pick all those parts. You can also get a system. And if you are average size, you know, average weight, you could probably do the standard bikes, and there's quite a variety. I actually have one, no, I didn't buy a custom-made bike, but I'll tell you that when I started working at IBM, I needed suits. I bought custom-made suits. Because for me, I'm shorter, I'm wider. Buying a suit off the rack doesn't work for me. So you can decide whether you're going to do that. Now, the interesting thing about buying the tailored suits is that as I've gotten bigger, which unfortunately happened to everyone, if you have a tailored suit, they actually leave room for you and they actually will open it up. And they'll, you know, so if I bought a suit that was a straight product off the line, I have to throw it away because I gain too much weight. But tailored suits, I've actually expanded them. Now there's a limit. But tailor-made suits are designed in a different way. So the idea of a living system versus more of a semi-line, so the actual term of autopoietic and allopoietic, are quite interesting, but they're technical. JP will talk to me about it afterwards. Okay, let's think about architecting. There's this great book called How Buildings Learn by Stuart Brand. Stuart Brand is a good American guy. He really wanted to study organizational learning. This is early 1990s. And organizational learning was not a topic that anyone could study because no one had studied it and there's no data. So he said, well, as opposed to studying something, a system of learning, why not study buildings and study architecture? Because we can think about architecture in a different way. And the question is the statement, how buildings learn. What does learning mean? When you have learning in a systems view, it's adapting the system to the environment. So the next question is, well, what's a system? There's two ways of looking at a building. You can look at it that the building is the built environment, and the people, the family living in the house is a system. You can also look at it the other way, which is that the people living in the house are the environment, and the building is the system. And that's what we've done here. So we have this idea of what he called originally shearing layers, and then later he republished it and called it pacing layers. And what he says is that if we think about the way the houses are constructed, firstly you start off with a site. You choose a site, and the site's eternal. Once you build a house on a site, it's really hard to move the house. You then build structure, which is the load-bearing walls. After you build the structure, you tend to build the skin, which is the stuff that protects it from the weather on the outside. Inside of the structure, you put in services. So services are all the plumbing, electricity, all the stuff that goes in the walls. You then have a space plan, which is the non-load-bearing walls. You're just dividing it up. So for those of you who do renovation work, I know you guys do, it's like, okay, we want to go through that wall. You can't go through that wall. It's got a duct in it. I want to go through that wall. You can't go through that wall. There's plumbing behind it. I want to go through that wall. No, we can go through that wall. No problem, we'll go through that wall. That is a space plan. That's a non-load-bearing wall. And then you have stuff. And the stuff is all the furniture and desks. So there's an interesting distinction here when you start talking about space plan versus stuff. Space plan, what's the difference between an armoire and a closet? So you can get a closet, you know, you open the door, you put your clothes in it. You got an armoire, which is a piece of furniture, you open the door, you put your clothes in it. The difference is that if you move from one house to another house, you can take an armoire with you, you cannot take a closet with you. A closet is part of the space plan, it is not part of the stuff. What problems do you want to solve? If you are a person that moves quite often and you like buying houses, you don't want renovating it, there's never enough closet space, why don't you just buy armoires and take them every place you go? So it's like you take your hanging thing with you all the time, right? That's a decision you make. That's an architectural decision. You could also see it as a design decision, but in this sense, it's an architectural decision. The interesting thing about the pacing layers approach is that it's about time. People tend to think about things that get attention, all things happen very quickly, short-term stuff. People don't pay enough attention to the long-term stuff, like the structure. They assume that the infrastructure is always going to be there. And so I was in Hominalina a couple of days ago, and there was my friend Mina was running a facilitating part of a meeting where the train company was coming in and they're talking about not stopping at Helsinki anymore, right? Which is a major change in infrastructure. And they're saying, oh, it's no big deal, it's only, you know, it's only a few minutes more, like they want to save 3 minutes on the line. And people are saying, yeah, well, that's half a minute to my, half an hour to my commute. That's what's a big difference here. Do you consider that infrastructure part of your structure, or is it part of your services? Because you can change these things, and maybe there are some things that you want slow that you don't want to change. So I got the strange question. How many people still have a landline in their house? Telephone landline? Nobody. I know this is Finland, everyone's mobile. I still pay for a landline in my house. And people think that's a bit strange, but we actually have more mobile phones in the house than we have people living in the house. But I retained the landline because I was in Toronto when we had a power failure across, you know, like New York State, Ontario, so it took up the whole eastern side. And the phone still worked. Because the phones are designed to work on low DC power, and it was designed in a different generation. So the reason that I want a landline is if the power goes out, I want to be able to use a phone. As a matter of fact, when the power went out, we'd have a gas range, and we had dinner as normal. The only thing is I had to use a match to light the stove. So people don't think enough about the old technology, these things like sight and structure that change very slowly. You take that for granted. Stuart Brand has this organization called the the foundation, the Long Now Foundation. Longnow.org, and I encourage you, if you haven't listened to Long, their podcast there, the podcasts are free if you listen to audio. I tell JP, download it onto your phone and listen to it while you're commuting. It's really great. The videos you have to pay for, if you don't remember Long Now. But essentially the idea is about long-term thinking. How do we change people from all the attention things that happen really quickly and get them moving towards the long-term thing?
In terms of kind of time, I think within the next 5 minutes it would be good to start a break. Before we'll be ready for 5 minutes.
Yes.
So just see how it fits with your...
We're at a point here, why don't we just stop right now and we'll come back.
Maybe 10 minutes. We'll take some time.
10 minutes? Okay. Maybe 10 more minutes.
We'll keep going. Okay. So, pattern language.
This is actually originally from the 1968 book. Why do you want to do pattern language? And these are patterns. I'm not actually going to tell you what they are, because I'll give you some examples. But a pattern language tends to get three types of help. Now these are architects. This is for architects. It's not for service design people. But it gives them the opportunity to use those patterns in a way which pays full respect to the unique features of each special building, its local peculiarities, the community, and its special needs. There are patterns that we recognize. So one major one, town square. So when I say town square, everyone goes, oh, I know a town square. But how many town squares do you know? Do they all work well? Do they work for the same function? So some town squares are big and they have markets coming on them, like, you know, twice a week or on weekends. So I was in Brussels and we went to the big market, you know, looking at, the selection was enormous. We were looking at hares and pheasants and horse meats and, you know, all sorts of stuff. So that would be thankful. Anyway, so there are town squares, there are little town squares, you know, just a little playground or something, a little bench posted on. But when I say town square, you recognize that. And so a pattern would be like a town square. And what we're saying is that when I say town square, you get the idea, but there are unique features. Because now it's like, okay, we're doing urban planning, you actually have to put the town square in this place. Well, when you put that town square in, it impacts other things about the street, it impacts where the buildings are. Now this is complicated, it's not complex. Right? But what happens is that if you think about the pacing layers approach, you're putting in a site. Do you want to put in do you want to plan the town square first? Or do you want to do other things first? So, you know, you have to put in sewers, you have to put in metro line underneath. Do you do the town square before you put in the metro line? Okay, so there is patterns how they tie together. And what you're working on is unique features. Secondly, it tells us which patterns to consider first and which ones to consider later. You want to consider the biggest one before you consider the details. This has to do with scales. The pattern language book actually has a subtitle, Towns, Buildings, Construction. From an urban planning perspective, urban architecture perspective, they want to do the big things first. So if you're going to put a metro in, you put in the metro first. Putting in afterwards is a lot more difficult. Putting in the roads first, putting in sewers, these are things going in a new division. These are all facilities you want to put in first because they're big and they're also should be slow. It tells them which patterns go together so we know which one to think about at the same time, which one separately. So I've been talking about these different patterns like town square. Are you going to have a town square? Oh, well, actually, we don't need a town square because we're on the edge of a forest and the town is so small that we don't need one. So, you know, so you make these sort of considerations. So the idea we're talking about service systems. What is it that makes a good service? And that's where we kind of get into doing pattern language.
Okay.
This is the pattern language that I proposed, the structure for it. The font is really small. Don't get scared, I'll go on the next page, bigger on the next page. But the idea is there's a pattern, and there's three there's three major groups of questions, the two that are systems related. There's a who and what, a how and a why, the where and the when, the containing system, and the contained system. And so I took Christopher Alexander's original 1968 work, which was a pattern manual for multi-service centers. This was designing what we called a multi-service center in, there's various examples, but the one I focused on was the one in Bronx, New York. This is a place that is actually one of the most economically depressed areas in the United States. There's drug use, you know, it's one of these places you really want to visit. And so they needed, in the 1968, they had the idea, well, why don't we do social programs? We will put in a medical center, health services, labor services, employment, you know, all sorts of things together. Government services in one place. So someone who is homeless, in effect, can go one place and get all their needs taken care of. That essentially is what they did. Now, in the patterns that he created, there were architectural patterns. And right up front, he says, I'm talking about the building and the built environment. I'm not talking about the services, even though it's a multi-service center. So I said, yes, and I'm a service science guy. I'll do the other part. So the three patterns that I rewrote, one was tapping into the grapevine. So when someone comes into a multi-service center, the idea is that there would be a bulletin board, because they want to know what people are doing in the neighborhood. So it's a reasonable sort of pattern. Everyone understands the bulletin board. But it's not about the bulletin board per se, because if you say bulletin board, people now think it's like cork board. It could be as complicated as mobile phones that are networked together. Or it could be a big TV screen on the wall. There's different ways of communicating information. It could be people talking to each other. So we don't want to focus so much on the implementation details, which is how you actually do that. We want to focus on what is the service that's being provided. So you think now, okay, I've got a bulletin board. What service does the bulletin board provide? Well, a bulletin board, if it's really informal, people can sell, you know, their own stuff. Now you don't want to have that. But you want them to know, one of the things that they wanted was jobs in the neighborhood. So if there's employment in the neighborhood, put it on a card, stick it up on the bulletin board, and that's kind of a service. There's definition of service, big service and little service, but if you have a service orientation, thinking about services, I call it tapping into the grapevine. There was a pattern called signing in for services. When someone comes in and it could be a health problem, it could be they're getting thrown out of their place because they don't have a rent, any of these number of different things, they need one place to go and sign in for services. There's different approaches to this. One would be you'd have what they call the arena, and you'd have like 50 different places that people go to each one desk. Or you could design it that people actually go to one place and get signed in. Christopher Alexander actually said he didn't want a desk. He wanted the people to sit down, and someone would come in and they say, Satu, nice to see you here. What are you here for today? And they would come to you. Why do they need a desk? Because it's much better to have just a waiting area and then just go to the people. It's the same sort of thing that when you talk about a retailer, some of them, they have the cash register, right? But now you have retailers who have an iPad and they come up to you, oh, you want to buy that? Okay, thanks, bye. My wife was commenting, she went to the bookstore or something like that, and they actually had two lines. They had one line with the iPad where they were checking all the stuff that she had, they put it into a shopping bag, and then she went to the cashier. And so you have multiple people actually checking what it is you want to buy, and one person taking cash or different function, and speeds things up. That's not thinking structurally, that's thinking about what is that part of the service, the function, the pattern of the service, so that's signing for services. The third one, and this one I'm going to focus on, and I'm going to blow up the font so you can see a little better, is minding children. So when someone comes to a medical center or a supermarket or something like that, they could have kids, a homeless person with kids. They have a doctor's appointment. What do they do with the kids? And in his pattern language, he designed there's got to be a place, a children's playground. Because the kids are going to play, it has to be supervised, has to be safe. But if you look at it from a services perspective, it's actually minding children. And the minding children could be formal. You could have a child social worker, someone trained in early childhood education, or it could just be other mothers who have to be there at the time. Because, you know, it could be just informal. It depends how you design. Okay. So the way that we're going to step through this is, I'll go through this pattern with you, is there's, we'll come back to the pattern label last, because it takes you a while to figure out what it is that you're doing. The first thing is who and what. Okay, so this idea of someone coming into a service center, and they have kids, drag the kid behind them. Who and what is going on? So here's three. For a client, what services are available we need now and on appointment? So there's an issue here, which is while they've got this kid with them, they want to be talking to someone, so the kid's got to be handling it. For a parent, what can I do with my kids while I'm busy? That's an issue. For a child, what can I do while my parents are at the multi-service center? So I'm posing this now not as a problem statement in the way that you want to do it, I'm posing it in the issues-based information system style. So I've taken the horse riddle wicked problem style of working and moved it over to the pattern language. Because the pattern language never asks a question. They just say, you do it this way. So asking a question is a better way of starting us off. And the way that I frame this is who and what. So think about who it is and what they want. The second part is the how and why. Leaving a child in a supervised play area, and the why is so that their whereabouts are known. The how, availing distractions for toddlers through teams, so this is getting the kids. What's the why? So they're coming with parents if that's a chore. Now this is technically, I call this an affording value. Affordances are, anyone in industrial design that heard the term affordance? Okay. An affordance actually started getting popular in the period of human-computer interaction when they first designed computer screens. And one of the more famous people is Don Norman. Don Norman's written these books, originally it was called Psychology of Everyday Things, now it's called The Design of Everyday Things. But he was actually the original user experience architect at Apple. So he's the guy responsible for designing the little garbage can on the Mac. And he was studying the work of J.J. Gibson, who had this idea of an affordance. An affordance is something that you interact with in the world. So a doorknob affords you the function of opening a door. When you see the doorknob, you recognize, you go, oh, I can open the door with that. So there's an affordance that's interaction. Now, the tricky part of the philosophy is the affordance is not just the doorknob. The affordance is the fact that when you see the doorknob, you know what it means. So when you're designing computer user interfaces, the reason they use folders, why do you use folders? Because folders are, we know folders in real space, and so we see a folder on a computer screen, and we go, that works like a folder in physical space. We make that tie. So a folder is an affordance on a computer system. Right? The reason that we talk about affordances, and this is a small technical thing, is that when you are providing a feature on a service, my question is, are you forcing the user or forcing the customer to use it? Do they have to use it or can they do something else? So when you come up to a door, you have the doorknob, you can push or you can pull with it. Do you have to use that? Well, you can actually just lean on the door sometimes if it's not locked, right? So you don't actually have to use the doorknob. You can just lean on the door. Your hands are wet, you know, go through the door backwards. These sorts of things. People do all those sorts of things. So the doorknob is an affordance, It affords you the ability to push and pull the door, but you don't have to use it. For service system thinking, we shouldn't be thinking so much of engineering, which is everyone does this the same way. We need to design this function, because as soon as you start getting that function, you get into requirements. Requirement says everyone does it this way. It's like, no, it's an affordance. Different people do things in different ways. Can we afford it? So we have a door. How many different ways could you open a door? You open it with your foot, you open it, grab the doorknob, push it on, lean on it, you do all sorts of things. They can afford them different ways. So that's the reason for the how and the why. Spatiotemporal frames. Okay, what is the frame for the pattern? This is the context for the pattern. So reminding children of the pattern. And so we have people coming in and making appointments. What's the frame? The facilities and programs are known both to children and parents in advance of appointments. So someone's going to come in, there has to be a building, and they have to know that if they come into the building, that someone's going to help them. Otherwise, why would they come into the building? The appointments could be done, the context, but the spatiotemporal frame is not done in the architectural sense. It's actually done from the human sense. Now we're talking about affordances. So you see a door, how do you know that door works? Most people just go push on it, right? I noticed there's signs on the door on here that says, do not lock this door. And I hope that when the sign says, do not lock this door, that every time I go through it, it's actually probably not locked. But there's probably going to be a case when someone says, please don't lock this door, it's still locked. So there is an idea that when we go through it, When I see that sign that says, do not lock this door, my assumption is the door is going to be open. There's nothing other indicators. I just assume that because that's a frame I have in my head. It has nothing to do with whether the door is really locked or not. It's in my head. With the mining children, we have, now we get into systems thinking. There's kind of the system. There is always a larger system and a smaller system. So the larger system, for extended family, school, community workers, what the personal responsibilities that inhibit service engagement. So we're talking about now people taking care of other people's kids. This is a public facility, it's run by the city. What is the responsibility of those kids? If the kid goes missing, like what is the liability there? Did you say you're going to take care of the kids, not take care of the kids? So all of a sudden now it's like, well, is that person qualified to take care of kids? So there's this larger system, because we're just talking about this one multi-service center. There's this larger system, which is the whole city, and what's their regulations on child care? Are they permitted to do that or not permitted to do that? So there's a bigger system at play. There's also a smaller system at play, a contained system, for other children, for other parents of the multi-service center at a certain time, when you look after my kids while I look after yours. So I go and I see Satchi there, and I say, oh, you're looking for my kids. It's like, I didn't expect you to be here, but now I know my kids are safe. That's not something government did, it's just informal, it's done very fast. So that's a pattern. That's not a perfect pattern. Remember I told you Christopher Alexander and his team, 253 patterns, it took 10 years for them to write the book. And even then, there are errors in the book, and they admit that. And a little bit of trivia, because you guys are old enough. So Wiki. Everyone knows what Wiki is, right? Because you know Wikipedia. You know about the history of Wiki. Wiki was invented by this one software developer named Ward Cunningham. Ward Cunningham invented Wiki to support pattern language. Because the idea that the patterns would be linked was something you couldn't do before that. You used to have paper, and then you change something here, you change something here, you change something else. You have to get permissions on computer files, stuff like that. So Wiki was invented for pattern language. And recently the work got used now. So all these things link together that way. But this is the way in which we're going to do our exercise.
I think it might be time soon.
Yes, we're going to do that. Yes, we're going to take that right now. This is going to be the outline that we're going to use. So as we take our break, I want you to think about, and we'll do a couple of them, what service system are you working in, and what are the features of that service system? Because we're going to talk about patterns within the service systems that you work in.
we're going to try, I'm going to sit down here, we're going to kind of work together, we're going to step through, we're going to try to do the pattern language together. So how long do we take for a break?
Let's take 15 minutes.
15 minutes? Thank you.